Good. Well, we're happy that you're here tonight, and we hope that God continues that good day for you and encourages you. But more than that, we're here to worship Him, because it is all about Him. And I want to say thank you for being here and worshiping, lifting up His name. And it is the name of Jesus that we want to think about tonight. So you sing about Him, you pray to Him, and we'll preach about Him, and you respond to whatever He has to say to you. And it'll be a good night, I know. I want to remind you that there are lots of things that are coming up in the coming days. And in order for you to know about those things, you have to read your bulletin. You have to read the app on your iPhone or your Android device. You need to get on our website and keep up with things. We have a remind system where we can send you things on your phone to remind you of things from time to time. And we can't always announce all of the things that are going to be going on. A lot goes on. And for that, we're thankful. And God's blessing it. And we trust that you'll find out how you can be involved and get involved. One thing that's going on right now, our youth and several adults are around Petahatchee on the way home. So continue to pray for their safety on the road. They've been to Operation Christmas Child and worked and did a lot of good stuff over there. Continue to pray for these teams who are coming in and out. Continue to pray for those folks in Panama City. You know, for every time that a team comes through, I'm reminded that people in Panama City are still struggling, and they're still hurting, and they're still needy. And these teams are still going through from Arkansas and Oklahoma. Florida has taken the lead on the disaster relief, but pray for all of those folks who are involved. And again, thank you for being so good to them. They appreciate it. You've got a great, we're getting cards now from the headquarters in Oklahoma and the headquarters in Arkansas saying thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So your name is known and widely known, and you have a good reputation, and that is a good thing. So continue to pray for those folks who are in need. And look forward to a few more things that are going to be coming up. Just a heads up for you. December is, there's something big happening in December, like Christmas. And we'll have a great opportunity to minister to people who are in need. And you will have an opportunity to encourage missionaries around the world through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. You'll also have the opportunity in December to look at a new budget. And so we'll announce ahead of time for you that that budget will be presented to you next Sunday morning, the first Sunday of December. And then on December the 16th, that morning, you'll have an opportunity for any questions from the floor at that point. But then we'll ask you to either approve, amend, or disapprove a budget on the 16th. So that'll give you 2 weeks to corner John Henry and say, hey, what in the world is this? And we hope you'll do that. But those things are coming up, and there are lots of other things that are coming up. So you be looking for those things and see how you can be involved. And it is just a joy to pastor a church that is so actively involved. And we try to be hands-off and let you do ministry. I don't know if y'all have noticed that or not. But that's the way church is supposed to work. The called out ones of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're the ones who are supposed to be doing the work and loving people and ministering. And we just want to help you do that the best we can. So it's exciting to see so many things going on. There are, believe it or not, I'm just kind of dense these days. And there are things that go on at the church I don't even know about. Some good, some bad, huh? But God's at work, and we're here to worship Him and to praise Him for that. And I hope you'll join me in prayer right now as we pray. Father, as we come tonight to lift up Your name, Jehovah Yahweh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we're very particular about who we worship tonight, because You're the one true God, the Creator of all the universe, Creator of us. Each individual person in this room, And through Jesus Christ, your Son, you are the Redeemer of our souls. And Father, we thank you tonight for sending your Son, Jesus, to live among us sinlessly and die for us, to raise him from the dead that we might know he truly is the Son of God, and that through him and his shed blood and sacrifice on the cross, we could be saved. Father, we've come into this place tonight just to reflect on that. Just think about who Jesus is and what he's done. And Father, it brings joy to our hearts to know that it is by your grace and love and mercy that it's been accomplished. Father, we do pray for our group that's on the road just now. Continue to keep them safe on this last leg of the journey. Continue to bless those in Panama City. Help them as they try to regain their lives and serve you. Thank you for these disaster relief teams who are constantly flowing through our doors, and we have the opportunity to display hospitality. And Father, your word tells us that as leaders of the church, we are to be people of hospitality. So, Father, thank you for giving us that opportunity. And Father, we pray that you will continue to save souls and that you might bring glory to yourself through the wonderful, dynamic, awesome works that you and you alone do, because you're the only one who can. Now, God, bless our church, bless our ministry, bless every outreach that we have, and remind us that everything we do is outreach, to reach out to the community and to give a witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us be busy about that, and help us right now to praise you and to give you glory. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you're able, stand with us. Let's worship in song this evening.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye.
God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you that we have the opportunity to come into your house. Lord, we do pray for Brother Malcolm as he stands before us and shares your word, your message to us. May we each take it into our hearts and our minds that we might carry it out from this place and share it with the world around us. Lord, as we come to this portion of the service, bless the gifts, well as those that give it, and we'll give you the praise and glory for all that's done. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, ladies. If you take your Bible and turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 17, we want to think about Peter, and how he moved from being just a simple, coarse, rough fisherman to being a leading apostle of the church of the Lord and a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ in a great way. And Peter, boy, why do we want to study Peter? Well, because I can identify with Peter. Open mouth, insert foot or feet or more. And I was just thinking before I got up here, you can't read my mind, and I forget that. Can anybody read my mind? Betty says it's too convoluted and chaotic to read, you know. I'm thinking what I said just a moment ago, that there's stuff that goes on around here that I don't know about. That's because there's so much good. Here's what we were thinking, and I didn't clarify. So much good stuff goes on that I can't keep up with all the good stuff, and so little bad stuff happens that I rarely hear about it. Now, that's what I was thinking, and since you can't read my mind, I had to say it out loud. I kind of think Peter was the kind of guy who was thinking a lot of the time and speaking, and then again, he was speaking and not thinking. And his mind was one of those that's hard to read, and I don't know how to read his mind tonight and what to say about what we're going to say. But we'll trust the Lord's going to lead us and guide us in Matthew chapter 17. Now, I would tell you that Matthew chapter 17 tells us about the Transfiguration. You've been singing tonight about Elijah, Moses. You've been singing tonight about glory. All those things kind of fall into place right here in Matthew chapter 17, those first 9 verses. And this is such an important story in the life of Peter and the life of all the other apostles, and especially the ministry of Jesus Christ, that it's repeated for us in the book of Mark. And that's in chapter 9, beginning with the first verse and following several verses. And then it's repeated again for us in the book of Luke, chapter 9, and it begins in verse 28 and goes on into the 34 range or so. And so each one of those stories is given to us, and I would advise you to go back and read all three and compare notes. We get a fuller picture of what's being said because different words are used in different gospels about what took place there on the Mount of Transfiguration. And so when you read all of those and you put them together, you begin to get this fuller picture of what God was doing there on that mountaintop. But we're going to read from Matthew 17. I might make a commentary or two from those other places, so you go home and read them later. Now, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, his clothes became as white as the light, and behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. And then Peter answered and said to Jesus, and I am sure tonight Peter says, I wish that were not in the Bible. Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Now, while Peter, was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, arise and do not be afraid. When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Now as they came down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead. I want to think about 3 or 4 things from this passage, and we'll move quickly if you'll listen quickly. The first thing that I want you to notice is the idea of the Trinity. I think the idea of the Trinity is presented to us on the Mount of Transfiguration. And you say, well, Pastor, what Trinity? Well, Peter, James, and John, of course. Let's think about them for just a moment, because they serve as a Trinity in the little sense of the word. Let's put a small T in front of the word Trinity for Peter, James, and John. And let me remind you that Jesus shows to us that he is fully human by selecting a few choice men to be his close friends. I think that's a mark of humanity. I think Jesus needed those men around to encourage his flesh, to encourage his humanity, to take part in what Jesus was facing. And he took courage from them. He had to correct them, sure. But one of the things that can lead a man, just a plain old man, just a fisherman, someone who is uneducated and unlearned like Peter, to become the great apostle Peter, is the fact that Jesus chose him to be part of an inner circle. And he spent time with him. And Peter saw some things that other guys didn't see. And Peter got to enjoy a privilege that some of the other guys did not get to enjoy. But Peter was not alone in that. Peter, James, and John are the three who were there. Now, when you get to thinking about the Mount of Transfiguration, it soon gets to be a pretty crowded peak. If you start thinking about everybody who was up there, who were they? Well, Peter, James, and John. But then there's another Trinity that we think about, and it's got a little bit bigger T, but it's still a small T in lots of ways. That is Jesus in his humanity. And Elijah and Moses. And those three are on the mountaintop now as well. And what is it that the mountaintop experience of Peter taught him about who Jesus was and what the ministry was all about? Well, it is colored by the fact that this Trinity was there on the mountaintop. It is a particular Trinity. It is a man who would represent the law, Moses. It is a man who would represent the prophets, Elijah. And then there is this man, Jesus Christ, who is there, who represents the fulfillment of all that these two guys have set forth. Jesus represents the fulfillment of the prophetic word from both Moses and Elijah. And so there is, in a sense, there is a Trinity that we think about there. And it teaches us some lessons, right? The Trinity of Peter, James, and John teach us something about the humanity of Christ and the way that Jesus is going to bring Peter from being just a fisherman of fish to a fisherman of men. That second Trinity that we think about teaches us something about Jesus and his being the fulfillment of all the law and the prophets. By the way, if you don't come to church on Wednesday night, shame on you. We meet for church every Wednesday night. What we do in the Bible study and the fellowship hall is right now we're looking for Jesus in the Old Testament. And we're looking in particular for those things that are confirmed to be illustrations and pictures and types of Jesus by way of the New Testament. Peter learns on the Mount of Transfiguration that Jesus is all over the Old Testament. James and John learn it too. They learn that everything that is in the law of Moses points to the coming Messiah. And Jesus is his name. They learn that all of the prophetic words of those prophets point to the coming Messiah, and that Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of those truths. Oh, but there's a third Trinity there. Trinity, Trinity, Trinity. Now I'm thinking about who is present on the Mount of Transfiguration. There was Peter, James, and John. And there was Jesus along with Elijah and Moses. But there are yet other people there. There are other people there. I would suggest to you that God the Father shows up. And now we speak about a Trinity with a capital T. God the Father. And then he says something about Jesus being his son. So there is God the Father and there is God the Son. Oh, but where is the Holy Spirit? Well, the Bible tells us that as the glorification of Jesus Christ was taking place, and these men saw it, they caught only a glimpse and fell as dead men, shutting their eyes, and a great cloud covered over that mountain. I suggest to you that the Holy Spirit has always been revealed as a fire or a pillar of fire or a cloud. I'd say that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were there on the mountaintop. For a glorious, glorious time, no pun intended. Well, I think not only about the Trinity, and if you're counting, that is Peter and James and John and Elijah and Moses and Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit. Eight. That's a pretty crowded mountaintop, isn't it? But they're all there. They're all there. And how do you get three Trinities out of just eight? Well, you got to remember that Jesus Christ is unique. He is a one of a kind. He's the only begotten Son of God, which means he is fully human and thus can serve on the mountaintop as one. But he is also fully divine, so he serves on the mountaintop in a second place as well. Well, think not only about the Trinity, but the Transfiguration itself. There is a statement that is given to us in chapter 16. It's repeated for us in Mark chapter 9, verse 1. It's repeated for us again in Luke chapter 9, verse 28. And it is this word: assuredly, I say to you, there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Have you ever wondered what that was all about? Well, if you've got a quote, good copy of the Word of God, those editors are going to help us with that just a little bit. And they're going to separate verse 28 out from chapter 16 and kind of attach it to chapter 17 and verse 1. After all, you have to remember that in the original language of the Scripture, there is no chapter verse separation. And so what we look for most often are paragraphs, because paragraphs are found in the Scriptures. And so it's unfortunate, maybe, that this verse is left off, but the editors get it right in Mark, and they get it right in the book of Luke. It flows better there. Now, what is that all about? Well, Jesus has just asked Peter, a few days prior to this transfiguration, who do men say that I am? And what did Peter say? What did the disciples say? What was the answer? Well, some say that you are John the Baptist, risen from the dead, right? Or maybe Jeremiah. Or maybe one other one that I remember hearing about. That was Elijah. You remember that? And so the Transfiguration, first of all, is going to show us that Jesus is not Elijah, because Elijah shows up and he's talking to Jesus. And Jesus is talking to Elijah. And by the way, what are they talking about? Only Luke's going to use this word, and he's going to tell us that they were talking about his exodus or his decease. His death. Because you got to remember that Jesus has looked at these guys and said, who do men say that I am? And that is when Peter has said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Well, that's great. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. The Father did. Good job. And then Jesus begins to speak about his death. And at that point, Peter pulls him apart and he says, "You got to quit talking about this death business. We don't want to hear it." And that's when Jesus looks at him and says, "Get thee behind me, Satan." You go from the pinnacle of compliments from the Lord Jesus, ooh, to the depths of a disparaging mark to be called Satan by the Lord Jesus himself. And so what's happening at the Transfiguration? Number one, there is a confirmation to Simon Peter and to the other guys that Jesus Christ is indeed the Son of God, and that he indeed is going to set up his kingdom, but it will be by the plan and purpose of God the Father alone. Not with any input from folks like Peter who don't have a clue. God's got this figured out. God's going to handle that. And so they are able to see a confirmation that Jesus is who he says he is. And they are the three that he's speaking about in chapter 16 and verse 28. "I say to you, there are some standing here," some. He's speaking to all the disciples. He's telling all of his disciples, "If you desire to come after me, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me." Then he says, "I say, there are some who are standing here who shall not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." Some, Peter, James, and John. They are on the Mount of Transfiguration, and they get to see the glory of who? The King. He shows himself as the King. And so the Transfiguration confirms for those three disciples and gives them something to go on when they're empty. Something to inspire them, something to encourage them when times get rough. They can think about having seen Jesus in all of his glory and his kingdom. But then it also confirms to Peter and the rest of them that Jesus is going to die. Because Luke, remember, tells us that they are speaking with one another. Moses and Elijah are speaking with Jesus, and they are all three talking about, and Peter, James, and John all hear them talking about Jesus and his soon coming death. And so Peter is confirmed in his great statement, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God," by the Transfiguration. He is also corrected by the prophets Moses and Elijah and the Lord himself as he says, "Not so, Lord. Surely you're not going to die." Jesus shows him it's got to happen. It's got to happen. Now, think not only about the Transfiguration in that sense, but remember that the Transfiguration is a revealing of the glory of Jesus Christ. And it had tremendous impact upon these men who were on the mountaintop with him. Don't you think it would on you as well? You ever prayed to see the glory of Jesus? You got a series of messages I used to preach. I don't preach them anymore because they ain't no good. I never preach a message a second time because they're never good enough to preach twice, hardly. But a series of messages that we like to think about, look at how people respond when they see the Lord high and lifted up, like Isaiah chapter 6, or Paul on the road to Damascus. These are changed people. Why? Because they saw the Lord. These men are changed here because they see Jesus Christ in all of his glory and all of that revealing of the glory. And it makes a difference. Peter, James, and John, two of those guys wrote books. Yeah, remember that? Peter wrote a book. Have y'all ever read that novel he wrote? He wrote two books, right? 1 Peter, 2 Peter. Let me remind you of what 2 Peter has to say in chapter 1. Now, this is the guy who was on the mountaintop with Jesus, and this is what an impact the Transfiguration had upon him. In 2 Peter chapter 1, and verse 15. You'll see it, but I want to start reading in verse 12, which is a paragraph. For this reason, I will not be negligent to remind you always of these things, though you know and are established in the present truth. Yes, I think it is right, as long as I am in this tent, he's talking about his body, to stir you up by reminding you, knowing that I must shortly put off my tent, just as the Lord Jesus Christ showed me. Moreover, I will be careful to ensure you that always, that you always have a reminder of these things after my decease. It's the same word right there, decease, that is used in the book of Luke in the context of the Transfiguration. It is the word Exodus. He's talking about when he dies. And then listen to verse 16. For we did not follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. When did that happen? Oh, well, all the way through his life. No, he's talking about a particular instance, a particular time. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory. Don't you love that title, the excellent glory? This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. When did that happen? The Mount of Transfiguration. Peter said, we heard this voice which came from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed. Now, that transfiguration made an impact upon Peter, and it gave him ammunition to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Well, let me quickly move on. I told you we would move. If you listen quickly, y'all are sluggish, so I'm slowing down. I just have fun up here, folks. I hope y'all do. We're thinking about the Trinity, oh, and all of its facets. We're thinking about the Transfiguration in particular and that glorious change of the Lord Jesus Christ. But thirdly, I want you to think about the testimony that was given to Jesus Christ at that point. And we just read it from 2 Peter because that really made an impact upon Peter. How did he move from being this little fisherman of fish to the fisherman of men? How did he change? How did he become this great apostle? Spending time with Jesus. One of the events that really affected him as he spent time with Jesus was the Transfiguration. And he heard something as well as saw something. He saw Jesus in all of his glory, but he heard a word from God. God the Father showed up on the Mount of Transfiguration and said, "This is my beloved Son." And so there is that word, that testimony of who Jesus is. This is my beloved Son. Now, you've got to remember that, well, I'm not going to preach it. Let me just tell you that if you go back to the Old Testament and you think about King David, you remember him? He had a son who followed him named Solomon. And if you will read, and y'all just did in some of your studies in Sunday school, if you will read over there, and maybe some of you power readers have just read it again. How many power readers of the Bible do we have in here tonight? Well, for you three, you will remember that the same style of language is spoken of concerning Solomon as it is the Lord Jesus. And the style is simply this, that to David, he understands that Solomon is his son and the rightful heir of a throne. Y'all go back and read it. I'm not going to go there, but y'all just know it's there. The language of the Bible is carried through here with Peter. It is carried through with the Mount of Transfiguration. It is carried through with God the Father saying, "This is my son." Now, who's saying it? God saying it from a cloud. Other places he's going to say, matter of fact, he says right here in Peter, Peter says he heard it from heaven. Now, who is God but the creator of the universe and in charge? And he says, "This is my son." So that makes him what? The king. The king. So the testimony is that Jesus is his son. But there's one other word from this testimony that you need to carry with you. Peter is this guy who is always opening his mouth and inserting foot, right? Peter's the guy who said, man, this is a fantastic place to be. I think we ought to set up some shacks and hang around a while. And God speaks up at that point and very clearly corrects Peter. Now, what was Peter saying? He said, let's build three tabernacles. Let's build three sheds or put up three tents, abiding places. Uses the same kind of an idea when you're reading in 2 Peter chapter 1 as he talks about his tent. Now, what was Peter doing and what was so wrong about it? Well, I don't know. Who in the world can read Peter's mind? But it was the wrong thing to say. We know that. Luke is going to tell us that he said what he said, not knowing what he said. Have y'all ever been there? People come up to me all the time, you know, you said in that sermon the other day, and they'll say something, and I go, I ain't preach that. I don't know where they got that. I didn't say that. People hear what they want to hear, don't they? Peter had to say something. You know, those two people in the world, there are people who have something to say, and then there are people who just have to say something. Peter just had to say something. And he says the wrong thing, as usual. Now, what was wrong with it? Well, he's elevating Elijah and Moses up to the level of Jesus, and he is pulling Jesus down. What's the whole point of the Transfiguration? What is the whole point of the testimony? What is the whole point of all of this glorification and the appearance of the Trinity, the Holy Trinity? What is the point? It is to elevate Jesus Christ to his rightful throne. And here you got Peter saying, we're going to build three tents and put y'all in it, bringing Jesus down and those prophets up. And God is saying, oh, no. No, 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 no. This is my beloved son. Moses is just Moses. Elijah is just Elijah. But Jesus is my son. And when they look, everybody's gone except Jesus. Now, what's God saying? Well, he said it very simply. Listen to him. Hear him. Don't worry about what Moses said. Don't worry about Elijah. Don't worry about following the law. Don't worry about following the prophecies. Follow Jesus, and you will ultimately follow all of it the way God wants you to. Now, that is some of the best advice I think that I could have for me tonight, is this word from God. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. Listen to him. How did Peter go from being a fisherman of fish to a fisherman of men? God drilled it through his head over and over and over. You got two ears and one mouth, shut up and listen. Hear him. What he has to say is most important. And then there's a final thought. What are the teachings that we learn from this? I've already told you. We need to hear Jesus. Why? Because he's the king. And his kingdom. You know, there are a lot of people who want to know, what is the difference between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God? Theologically, there is a difference. There is a distinction made in Scripture in some ways. But I want to carry you back to a place tonight and just simply say this, that the kingdom is all about the king. The kingdom of heaven, it's all about the king. The kingdom of God is all about the king. The coming kingdom is all about the king. And the transfiguration miracle lets us know this, that Jesus Christ is the coming king. Hear him. I want to read one more scripture and I'm done. But we pray the Holy Spirit will use it. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. John both your brother and companion in tribulation and kingdom. And patience of Jesus Christ was on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now listen, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what you see, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man. And I believe that what we have right here is a description of what he had already seen on the Mount of Transfiguration. One who is now fully glorified and in charge. And John looks and he says, I saw one like the Son of Man. Like he was on the Mount of Transfiguration. Like he was in all of his glory, all of his radiance, all of his majesty, all of his might. He was clothed with a garment down to the feet, girded about his chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white as wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp, two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. When I saw him, I fell as dead at his feet. But he laid his hand on me, saying to me, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. So reminiscent of what he had seen already. But now he sees Jesus Christ in his complete and total glory as the lawgiver, far beyond Moses. As the prophet of things to come, far beyond measure compared to Elijah. He sees him as that glorious king who's going to make all things right. So Jesus says, who's been the theme of this whole thing? Well, Peter's just a device. He's just an instrument. He's just another person that God has used to reveal to us all of these aspects and all of those facets of Jesus himself. But what was revealed to Peter moved him from being just a fisherman of fish to a fisher of men. Isn't that who you want to be? You want to be just a plain old person of the world? Or do you want to be a person of the kingdom? It's all about Jesus and what you do with him. Bow at his feet tonight. Father, help us as we go into a time of imitation. Help us, Father, to respond appropriately. God, I'm still convinced that if some of us were to see Jesus in all of his glory right now, we'd be on the floor. I don't remember when I saw somebody on the floor in worship, God. But I thank you that I have seen it. God, remind us all tonight that when we see Jesus for who he is, we'll see ourselves for who we are. We'll cry out as Isaiah did, woe is me, for I'm undone. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of an unclean people. Father, help us to come to that place tonight where we see Jesus and Jesus alone. And realize that by seeing Jesus and hearing from God the Father and from the lips of the King, we are changed. And Father, if we need anything tonight, we need changed hearts. God, you do that work tonight, that you may be glorified in all that we do. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand and sing, and you come right now.